Curator received his Bachelor of Arts in Psychology with a minor in Women's Studies from the University of Connecticut, Storrs, and his Juris Doctor from Brooklyn Law School. Currently, he's assistant to being Assistant General Counsel and Privacy Officer for Healthcare Risk Advisors Incorporated, a New York-based risk management company, focusing on risk mitigation, insurance regulation, and loss prevention. In this capacity, he works with some of New York City's largest hospitals, long-term care facilities, and social service agencies. Besides law, Ricardo is also an adjunct professor, teaching in the areas of finance, risk management, and insurance. Living in his true pain passion, Ricardo also serves as creative director for Pepperjack, an amazing startup fashion powerhouse focusing on swimwear and the female aesthetics. Ricardo has an innate passion for fashion and the arts, focusing on self-expression and individuality with a flair for colors. Here's Ricardo's.
Thank you, Lisa. You know, there's one thing that I've learned as I've grown in my 25 years. On this earth, I'm not 25 actually, but you know, sometimes you just say whatever age you want and you go with it. And that is, history is something that must be lived, it must be experienced, and most importantly, it must be explored, right? So when someone is written out of history or silenced, that attacks the very foundation, the very spirit of that person. That's what happened to Jay Jaxon. Jay Jaxon was the first, right, American designer to be in Paris, the first Black designer to be in Paris to run a fashion house. And somehow, magically, he was written out of history. But thanks to the hard work, the dedication, and the investigative spirit of Rachel, we're now able to bring this man back in the role that he rightfully did. Before Virgil of Louis Vuitton, before Paul Williams of Carl Kanai, before Sean John, before them all, there was Jay Jaxon. And I am just happy Rachel was able to bring him back into our focus. For his loved one, he never went anywhere, right? You all knew his story, but we didn't. For his friends, same thing. But through the hard work and dedication of Rachel, I am glad that we are able to sit here today and learn everything that we need to know about this amazing designer, this amazing figure. So, Rachel Fenderson, the curator of this amazing exhibit, was born and raised in Queens, New York, to Jamaican parents. Let me put on my second pair of eyes. During her youth, she worked hard as a student while being drawn to fabrics, design, and creation. This dichotomy at times would be a thorn, sometimes a stepping stone, and ultimately the key to Fenderson's success. In 2002, Rachel pursued a bachelor's degree in English literature at Hofstra. Next, Rachel set her sights on attending Parsons, the new school for design, and completed a fashion studies applied associate science degree of fashion design in 2008. On January 1, 2011, Rachel and her sister Marsha founded a women's wear company, Pepperjack. By 2016, Rachel decided to fully immerse her life and world into fashion by furthering her education at Parsons Paris in Paris, France. In May 2018, Rachel successfully defended her master's thesis, Jay Jaxon, a biographical study and media discourse analysis, reinstating a designer into fashion history. Pursuing this degree gave her the opportunity to write the first biographical thesis study on the designer, Jay Jaxon, with a foundation rich in investigatory research and critical analysis. Rachel displayed her first exhibition on Jaxon at the Monica Bismarck in Paris in 2018. And now today, you are experiencing the Jay Jaxon exhibition held here at the Queens Public Library for this entire month of August. Please look forward to honoring the 50th anniversary of Jay Jaxon's historical fashion role. Rachel will exhibit Jaxon's work, his life, and historical contribution at the Queens Historical Society from February 1, 2020 to December 31st, 2020. Let's all give a round of applause for Rachel.
I'm feeling good. So the foundation of this exhibition celebrates the life of Jay Jaxon as a fashion designer, as an haute couture designer, and as a costume designer. I titled this exhibition Jay Jaxon, Fashion Designer, Le Couturier, Costumer, 40 Years of Fashion Design Brilliance. The impetus for creating this biographical exhibition on the fashion designer Jay Jaxon stemmed from my master's thesis, a biographical study, and media discourse analysis, reinstating Jay Jaxon into the fashion history. Now, I will discuss key objectives of my exhibition, which fall in the realm of legacy preservation, challenging the narrative, and leveling the playing field. The principal aim of this exhibition is to reinstate Jay Jaxon into the historical fashion narrative in three key aspects, which are to display his biographical history, writing his biography, which I developed through oral history and narrative writing, and lastly, the designer archive, which I individually built through the cultivation of sources I amassed through my research. By weaving a thread between specific events in fashion history, American history, and the exhibition explores how racism permeated the fashion industry, all the while illuminating exclusionary narratives and tactics utilized to box designers in through racial labeling. Thus illustrating Jay Jaxon's penetration in the industry shows how social constructs and barriers obstructed his fashion trajectory in America and abroad. Brother was Robin Rihanna Fenty for Fenty in 2019, Virgil Abloh for Louis Vuitton in 2018, Olivier Rostand for Balmain in 2011, Oswald Boateng for Givenchy in 2003, Sham Syndicat member Patrick Kelly in 1988, there was Jay Jaxon for Jean Lucherier in 1969. I utilized Toni Morrison's literary technique from her book, The Bluest Eye, regarding the colloquial saying, quiet as is kept. Actually, let's just take a moment to turn to my thesis so that I can expand on Toni Morrison's use of the term. The colloquial saying, quiet as is kept. That's actually Toni Morrison's voice that I had inserted into the actual presentation. The colloquial saying, quiet is kept, is usually a precursor to gossip performed by women in the Southern Black communities. Toni Morrison uses it as an opening statement in her novel, The Bluest Eye, to not only alert the Black audience that she was writing about a topic not typically addressed outside of the Black community, but also to bring her white audience into the conversation on how imbibing negative ideas about identity as a result of racism birthed colorism. So thank you to Toni Morrison, our rest of paradise. Now, let me introduce you to Jay Jaxon. Over 50 newspaper articles were written and reprinted on Jay Jaxon during his lifetime. Yet, he remained hidden in the fashion history and historical discourse. The media proclaimed Jay Jaxon to be the first American and African American to create haute couture for Paris. Why is Jay Jaxon not in the fashion historical narrative? Why is his history not toy? I had questions regarding who is responsible, if it is due to racism and discriminatory practices, if it is due to how creatives are treated behind the scenes, or if it is due to how hegemonic histories are written and told. Perhaps the answer is all-encompassing, which of the matters which afflict the fashion industry today. Nevertheless, it is hard to quantify feelings and innate discriminatory practices that would illuminate why Jay Jaxon was left out of the fashion historical narrative. So I'd like to actually bring you guys in to my methodology and primary sources, which is also what I used to help me to build the exhibition. In order to display a cohesive story, I collected 7 key sources to exhibit Jay Jaxon's history, which are interviews, resumes, correspondence, newspaper articles, fashion media, and garments, Jay Jaxon's portfolio as well. In order to problematize hegemonic histories and perform critical discourse analysis on critical work that I performed in terms of researching newspapers, I utilized different types of theory. The first is W.E.B. Du Bois' critique on hegemonic histories. So the books are actually listed here. James Baldwin's theories on the impact of whiteness, Stokely Carmichael and Charles B. Hamilton's definition of institutionalized racism, and Michel Foucault's theories on power and systems of control. Furthermore, I tap into Chet Jeffers' theories on national identity, Andre Coleman's theories on nationalism, Fred Davis's theories on clothing communication and how clothing frames identity, and Langston Hughes' I Too Sing America in the poetry of the Negro. James Baldwin's theories on what it means to be an American. In order to help us understand and frame the time period of Jay Jaxon's formative and early beginnings in fashion, I will present a series of footage from Raoul Peck's documentary, I Am Not Your Negro, as well as information from the Jim Crow era.
History is not the past, it is the present. We carry our history with us. We are our history. If we pretend otherwise, we literally are criminals.
So this footage speaks to the questionable histories. Fashion historian Valley Stroh declares that fashion has been described as capitalism's favorite child. If fashion is the child of capitalism, then fashion has a slew of siblings known as racism, colorism, classism, sexism, homophobia, and xenophobia. All of fashion siblings play key roles in the systems of fashion as we know it today. It caused barriers to entry and to the success of Jay Jaxon centuries prior to his existence, hence making his story extraordinary. Next, you'll see footage of James Baldwin speaking to the issues of America.
And there are days, one of them, when you wonder what your role is in this country, what your future is in it. How precisely are you going to reconcile yourself to your situation here, and how you're going to communicate to the vast, heedless, unthinking, cruel white majority that you are here. I'm terrified at the moral apathy, the death of the heart, which is happening in my country. These people believe themselves for so long. They really don't think I do. I have basis on their conduct, not on what they say. And this means that they have become, in themselves, moral monsters.
Okay, so Baldwin's thoughts on America and the majority speaks to the issues that permeated the fashion industry. Thus, in the fashion historical run-through, I proclaim, fashion is a living, breathing entity that is ever transient and cannot be contained to one set of rules and laws. I believe wherever humans are present, fashion lives in their cultures and customs. It is determined by their cultural rules or codes, and in a format that does not need to be situated in the paradigm defined by the Western fashion standards. To label or to not to label. When racial labeling occurs in safe spaces, it is for necessity and exposure. It is not done in a discriminatory manner. When racial categorization is done by institutions which are deemed to be the mainstream and whose history is riddled with racist acts, it becomes problematic. It can ultimately present as a form of discrimination and othering. Who is Jay Jaxon in this article? Yvette Delafontaine's newspaper article titled, Young Black Trying to Save Couture House, French Turned to American for Fashion. There are three forms of categorizations that were placed on Jay Jaxon, and it can easily be identified. Delafontaine's distinction of Jaxon as a couturier by his race and then nationality is instantly shown in the article's opening title. This distinction is not only a social practice of the time, but also a hegemonic behavioral pattern into the other. So here I actually decided to show a newspaper article, which is by Jane Nguyen Rusak, and her article is titled How to Be Stylish Wet. Part of the reason why I called upon this journalist is because she utilizes Jay Jaxon as a fashion designer. And here it shows Jay Jaxon presented as a fashion designer while utilizing his garment featured on the right. And this is from 1975. Lastly, featured here is an advertisement of the Ebony Fashion Fair, which raised more than $7 million for charitable causes and a scholarship for colleges. This fashion fair would also go on to tour 160 cities during the fall of 1977, featuring 200 designers and accessories. Ebony Fashion Fair does not promote the race of these designers to distinguish or to separate them in hierarchy of disenfranchisement. Rather, it's done to uplift them. Next, you will see James Baldwin speaking to the issues of being invisible.
Leaving aside all the physical facts of one's folks, leaving aside rape or murder, leaving aside the bloody catalog of oppression, which we are in one way too many of us already. What this does to the subjugated is restoring his sense of reality. This means, in the case of an American Negro, born in that glittering republic, and in the moment you are born, since you don't know any better, every stick and stone and every face is white. And since you have not yet seen a mirror, you suppose that you are too. It comes as a great shock around the age of 5 or 6 or 7 to discover that Gary Cooper killing off the Indians, you were rooting for Gary Cooper, that the Indians were you. It comes as a great shock to discover that the country which is your birthplace and to which you owe your life and your identity has not in its whole system of reality evolved any place for you.
So James Baldwin is speaking to the issues of being invisible in the world as a person of color. Thus, the impetus for this magazine issue was motivated by the presidential race run by the now first ever African-American president of the United States, Barack Obama, and the lack of diversity in the fashion industry. This magazine issue is now a guide for how not to approach diversity, inclusivity, and representation. Instead of advocating for women of color or black in an uplifted way, Bogotalia places them on an unleveled playing field. Versus positioning them equally next to their counterparts in a consistent manner. So pretty much, this was a one-off issue, and it never happened again. The vote issue, I consider, is that it's not a safe space, and here I offer Ebony and Jet magazines, which flourished during Jay Jaxon's life, and were deemed safe spaces because they were started to present the construction of the narrative about black people in the world and how to combat negative stereotypes based on racism. Now, let's turn to Jay Jaxon's life. I wanted to answer how his story is important to the fashion narrative, how do the historically absent and or admitted designers give themselves auto agency after their career has ended and or they pass on. So Jay Jaxon was born in the heart of the Jim Crow era to Mr. Sidney Jaxon and Mrs. Ethel Rena Jaxon on August 30th, 1941. Now I would like to give you context to the Jim Crow era. Here is a video.
Jim Crow as a synonym for segregation. And this showcase has objects that we would more traditionally associate with segregation. One of the lessons of the Jim Crow Museum is that Jim Crow segregation was so pervasive that it was omnipresent, that it was in every aspect of American society. Every major societal institution, the family, the government, the media, the military, higher education, all major institutions in our society bought into the idea that whites were superior to blacks in all ways that mattered. In every day, in every aspect of the society, the racial hierarchy was cemented and manifested.
So Dr. Pilgrim is speaking to how Jay Jaxon's world was affected from the time he was born. So much so that his siblings, Arlene, Helen, Sidney, and Jaxon on the bottom right had to ration food as children. Their father, who was college educated, was unable to get a job as a black person. The irony here is that the same government which prohibited him from getting a job tried to take the children away. Jaxon's mother stopped this from happening and preferred that they be a family unit together. If we look at the time period Jaxon was born in, the Jim Crow era, and when he moved to Paris during the civil rights era, it almost seems overtly obvious that he would have been written about extensively and considering the various obstacles and barriers to entry for a person of color.
White people are astounded by Birmingham. Black people aren't. White people are aimlessly demanding to be reassured that Birmingham is really on Mars. They do not believe still, less to act on belief, that what is happening
realize that there is not one step morally or actually between Birmingham and Los Angeles.
So, after survivalist and ascending to the heights, Jay Jaxon reached in the fashion world. As the first, one would think that he would be cemented in the fashion historical narrative. Now, I will discuss Jay Jaxon's historical contributions. Jay Jaxon's fashion career began after designing a dress for his then-girlfriend, Renee Hunter. Jaxon graduated from Hunter College, went to law school, and left to study fashion at FIT. During the late 60s in New York City, Jaxon designed for Gilbert, Jimmy Sophisticates, Donald Brooks, and Klein for Royal Lynn. Jaxon sold his own pieces to the luxury department stores Henri Bendel, Bonnet Taylor, and Lord & Taylor, garnering enough money for him to pursue fashion abroad. In February of 1968, Jaxon moved to France. The beginning of his career in Paris would commence a few months prior to the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., a prominent leader of the civil rights movement, as well as the May 1968 massive student-led protests in Paris. Jaxon gained a wealth of design knowledge by working for these couture maisons, Jean-Luc Chabert as the head designer and assistant designer, Yves Saint Laurent and Marc Bohan for Christian Dior, as the assistant designer. After leaving his post at Jean-Luc Chabert, Jaxon created his own brand, which was showcased in the American Cultural Center in October 1970. Once again, Jaxon would return to Jean-Luc Chabert as the assistant designer and then the Grand Couturier. In the mid-70s, Jaxon returned to New York City and once again created his own collections while designing for Pierre Cardin, Jay Jaxon for Benson Partners, Jay Jaxon for Juju, Jay Jaxon for Monet, and Jay Jaxon for the New Pliers. Finally, in the mid-80s, Jaxon moved out to California at the persuasion of his play cousin, Lester Wilson, the renowned choreographer. While in Los Angeles, Jaxon designed for Jill Richards, creating theatrical costumes for celebrities such as Thelma Houston, Diane Carroll, Sammy Davis Jr., and Luther Vandross. For television, he designed costumes for The Division, Angel, Ally McBeal, Sabrina the Teenage Witch. In film, Jaxon created costumes on behalf of Mr. and Mrs. Smith, the Men's Club, and in stage, Ailey celebrates Ellington and the Colors for Christmas. The brief account of the events of Jay Jaxon's life displayed here are significant achievements in fashion. From the onset, Jaxon's success in the fashion industry would have appeared to be written about widely, researched in depth, as his non-black counterparts. In the end, this illuminates why Jay Jaxon's story is imperative to the fashion narrative because it helps to level the playing field, makes fashion as a whole more productive when it's inclusive, constructive representation of designers of color is important. This representation illustrates that there are successful designers making headway in the fashion industry. Secondly, it is important to see a positive reflection of people who look like you propped up in the industries which have generally been closed off to them. On July 19, 2006, Jay Jaxon, formerly known as Eugene Jaxon, succumbed to a long battle with cancer. Jaxon's remains were interred at his mother's gravesite in Springfield Garden Cemetery, located in Queens, New York. Jaxon was survived by his eldest brother, William Robinson, his sister, Helen Lee, his sister, Arlene Patterson, his nieces and nephews, and his life partner, Lloyd Harvey. Jay Jaxon's history in American fashion design, French haute couture, and costume design opened doors for a diverse set of designers to create their own legacies. When looking at the career of Jay Jaxon, and how racism had a huge impact on the trajectory in both French and American fashion, the industry. His brilliance is not only in the creations, but it's in his perseverance. Jay Jaxon's legacy will live on through his work, resume, portfolio, family and friends oral history, obituary, my academic master's thesis research, and fashion retrospective exhibition. In the end, the fashion industry lost a fashion point, quiet as it was kept.
Our first panelist is Renee Hunter. Renee Hunter was born and raised in Brooklyn, New York. During her adolescent years, Renee moved to Queens, New York, where she would enroll in Queens College. After attending the Couturier Awards with Jay Jaxon, this event became the impetus for the start of her career in the fashion industry. Hunter would drop out of school 2 days later. Throughout the next 8 to 10 years, she became a successful model. Upon continuing her love for the fashion industry, Renee branched into the corporate side as a fashion coordinator, and then was promoted to the role of a fashion director for Bloomingdale's. Renee specialized in the buying of women's dresses, coats, suits, and leathers. Next, Renee joined Saks Fifth Avenue as a fashion director, specializing in the same field. She would spend the next 10 years at the department store, eventually leaving her role as a buyer of luxury goods. Renee would take her fashion expertise to FIT and to the Laboratory Institute of Merchandising, becoming a professor of fashion. Renee is now retired and still in love with fashion. Let's give a round of applause for her. Our next panelist is Ranald White. Ranald's unparalleled 50-year reign in the model industry as the country's top male fashion icon is celebrated for its many firsts. Born and raised in Newark and East Orange, New Jersey, the actor and model's stellar career began at a time of extraordinary unrest. He threatened the authorities, breaking down barriers, determined to make his own contribution to the civil rights movement, and in doing so, was able to accomplish the following. The first African-American model to appear on the cover of GQ. The first African-American male model to endorse white luxury products. First African-American male model to work for the American designers Bill Glass, Calvin Klein, Ralph Lauren, Jeffrey Banks, and Donna Perry. Ranald has been featured in the editorial pages of American Vogue, Harper's Bazaar, and Esquire. His unique cover for an all-black issue of Vogue is still a standout. On an historic mission to outer space, African-American astronaut Lou Ferdis Guyon, that's the last name, tucked Renee's 1983 cover story for Right On Class magazine into his time capsule, which since its return to Earth has been housed in the Smithsonian. While in 1979, he was the first African-American model to appear on the groundbreaking cover of GQ, his image subsequently appeared in more than 20 issues and inspired an entire generation of black men to follow their dreams. He also worked for Europe's YSL, Valentino, Armani, and Versace, and has endorsed commercial products and services for the Jamaica Board of Tourism, Delta Airline, Chrysler, Bank of Boston, and Miller Lite Beer, just to name a few. He was the only black man among 10 recipients to be honored by Fortune magazine as a highly successful leader in fashion modeling. Ranald also had the distinct honor of being one of the 5 persons named to receive the prestigious Style Award given by the Fashion Outreach Association. As an actor, Ranald has drawn critical acclaim for his regional theater work, most notably for Julius Caesar, and especially for his portrayal of Malcolm X in When the Chickens Came Home. Other credits include New York Theater, feature and independent films. Even more currently, he has been seen on the CBS daytime serial, Dying Light, and ABC TV's One Life to Live, and in numerous commercials. Committed to community service, he shares his modeling and acting experiences in lectures, motivational speeches given to students throughout the country from elementary to university level. He also serves as an ambassador to the Horse Sport for Good Foundation USA, doing grassroots works amongst the communities it represents with its mission for social change. He plans to share his experience, insights, and day-to-day success in his forthcoming book. Renald says he strongly believes in being spiritually, mentally, and physically fit. He thanks God for his family, friends, and his community. Let's give a round of applause for Renald. Our next panelist is Jay Jaxon's lifelong friend, Linda. Linda was born and raised in Harlem, New York, and moved to Queens during the beginning of the summer for the senior year of her high school. Linda worked as a journalist photographer. She has raised sheep for 10 years, now travels the world. Let's move on. Our last but certainly not least panelist is Elle Lewis. Elle received his bachelor's in fashion merchandising with an emphasis in dress sociology from the University of Georgia. He currently lives between New York and Atlanta while working as a creative strategist and fashion editor stylist. He specializes in styling, brand direction, content creation, digital marketing, and e-commerce. He has worked for brands such as Alexander Wang, Essence Magazine, Brights, Amazon, Barney's, Nordstrom, and domestic and international fashion tech startups. Lewis has now co-founded a tech apparel company called Vogue. Let's give it up for him. So I really want this panelist and this discussion to be interactive. You know, I am going to post some questions. Feel free to elaborate. Feel free to jump in.
Oh, how did you get your start in the fashion?
Right. So I had met Jay through Lester Wilson and I were dating. We were in Queens College and freshmen, and we were hanging out. And I met Jay because Jay and Lester were very good friends. And so that's how we met. I don't know what year that it was. So I wanted to bring my guess. Early 60s. And that's how we met. And Lester went on to the computer and very good friends. And Jay and I were still here with him. I was going to Queens College, majoring in English. And when I finally got back to friends again, he was in FIT. That
many years ago.
No, how did you get in the industry? What steps did you take? What are some of the challenges you faced as the first in so many different things?
I never even thought about it in high school. I was just getting through high school. I knew that that could all be good. But once I got out of high school and started working, I found fashion. And I used to go to thrift stores, and old Army and Navy stores, just to find unique looking colors. So then I realized that I had this desire to present myself. So after losing weight and developing literary style, somebody gave me a piece of paper saying, you should go see this person within the next week. They're having a men's fashion show. And I went, who are you talking to? He said, you. I said, why? He said, because I think we have some. So I took the information and I went up to Bill Glass. He said, 550 7th, the 10th floor I walked in, I had nothing with me, no photographs or anything. I never did a fashion show in Europe whatsoever. And the person who was interviewing the potential people was Tom Fallon, who was actually still in the business. So Tom said to me, all right, young man, can you walk down the front, which was my nerd walk. And he said, okay, how many shows have you been in? I said, none. He said, oh, okay, can you give me a photograph? I said, I don't have a photograph. I'm just starting out. This is the first time I've ever done anything like this. He said, well, all right, put your phone number down. After we decide who we're going to use, if you're in that group, we will call you and we will tell you to come back, and Bill Blass will look at you and decide what you're going to wear. I said, fair enough. So I left, not thinking anything. And I get down to the main floor, and I walk out the building, and I see a phone booth. Everybody know what a phone booth is? Okay. And it had yellow pages. Yellow pages? I looked into modeling. I figured, why go back to New York? I'm in New York. I'm on 557th Avenue. So I found this name, and it was Ford. It was Eileen Ford. Now, my mother, who was a very beautiful woman, and she actually modeled when she was young in New York, had wonderful skin. And she used to read and apply things that the major fashion people would recommend for women who were housewives or not within the working force. So I knew that Ford name had something to do with fashion. So I figured, well, I have nothing else to do. Let me walk over. So I walked from 40th and 7th over to 59th and 1st, and it was a brownstone. And I walked in, and the woman at the desk said, oh, upstairs. So I went upstairs, and I thought, oh, that was easy. And then I realized she thought I was delivering something. So, which is fine, because we were doing it. We were still doing it. The woman behind the desk said to me, after like looking at her display of black models, how tall are you? I said, I'm 6'3". She said, what size is your suit? I said, I think it's about 42 now. She said, you're probably a long. And she said, is that a scar on your nose? I said, yeah, it is. She said, oh, okay. So I went, I'm black. I got a scar on my nose, and I'm too tall. She said, however, let me give you this card, and I want you to follow through on this. This is very important for you to have. It turned out to be Wilhelmina. So she said, we can't take you because we have our share of African-American men. And they sometimes have to supplement their modeling career with jobs. So we have our share, but maybe Wilhelmina, who just opened up within the last 5 years, has not. So I figured, all right, I'll take it. So from 59th and 1st, I went up to 527 Madison Avenue. But something happened to me within that walking period. I realized that I had just sort of experienced racism. And there was something that took over, which was very unpleasant. So when I get to 527 Madison Avenue, I look on the directory and I see Wilhelmina on the 11th floor. So I take the elevator up. And when I stepped outside of the elevator, I knew I had to be somebody else. I had to come out outside of this young guy, boy kind of person. So I walked in the office, and there was a woman at the desk, and I said, I'm from the NAACP. And if you don't show me your quota of black models, I will have tickets tomorrow. And she went, what? What are you talking about? I said, can I repeat myself again? And she said, no. Just don't do anything. So she picks up the phone, and she speaks into it very intently. And within 30 seconds, out come two very officious looking people. One was a producer of the Tonight Show that Jack Parr was. I don't know anybody who wants Jack Parr. But Jack Parr was on the show, and the other woman was Fran Rothschild of the Rothschild Fortune from Europe. They were two vice presidents at Wilhelmina. And the
young lady at the office had said to me, there's a African-American guy here who might be picking up tables and throwing them across the room, so you better get out here quick, because you could get very angry. And so they came out, and they said, and who? So I said, I'm an old white New York, New Jersey, and East London, New Jersey. I'm over here. I'd like to know about modeling. I don't see my image on New York, but I'd like to change that. I want to be a part of that. My city just got burnt down a year ago in 1967. And I said, we're tired of it. We want to see you. We want to see inspiration. We want to be inspiration. We want our life here to be as good as yours. So they said, wow. So they weren't sure if I was going to pick up a table and throw it across the room, because they had beautiful little blonde girls waiting to be interviewed with their mother. So they figured, let me get them out of the way. But I said, this opportunity only comes along once. I just made it for myself, and I'm going to hear what they have to say. So they said it was a very challenging profession. One of the top guys came in, and they said, this man is a moneymaker. And they said, Jerry, talk to this young man in all of what he's from New York, New Jersey. So they were working for him. And he was explaining to me what he had to do, wardrobe, photographs, build his portfolio, learn how to work out every day. I said, that sounds like a dream job. So they said to me, look, come back. We can't do anything now. We've already given you way too much time. So you have to come back, and we'll talk about it less time, and we'll have to work with our quota of black men. So think about cutting your hair and just kind of slimming down the board. Well, let's see what we can do with you. So I said, fine. So you'll see me. So I went back the next day. I didn't have all that stuff done, but I went back the next day to show them I was serious. And they decided that they didn't have that many young black men. And since I came to them with some intent, they thought I would be the real thing. So they gave me a contract. And they thought, he's probably going to take the contract and get frustrated and not go out every day like he's supposed to. So let's just give him about six weeks. Well, it turned into, I think, 10 years I was going in. And that's how I started.
So. So in terms of the initiative that you really described, do you think it would actually work today for any young black male model to get in, whether it's at Wilhelmina or whoever?
See young people all the time. And there's always going to be people who shy away from the crowd and do their own thing. So I say yes. I think there are people who are eager enough to break the rules because they wanted that gap when they're young. There's nothing stopping them. They have this creativity, which is God's gift. And all they can do is just go forward with it.
Thank you. Linda, could you describe or tell us anything about really what went into his designing? How his creative juices really flow? Can you give us a behind the scenes?
There's really no way that I can tell you what made Jay creative. He was just a very creative individual. I remember when he returned to New York, he needed a table to design on in his apartment, and he simply designed it and had it manufactured. He was simply a very, very creative individual.
Did you get a chance to see any of his collection to see his design process really like me?
I would say that I probably saw all of Jay's creative projections. I knew Jay for a very long time. Sometimes we just hang out in his studios and he would draw and we'd eat. And he would say, well, what about this or what about that? And I would say if I liked it or I didn't like it, which had no bearing on anything because I'm not in the fashion industry, but I expressed how I felt about it. And his level of
of interest, I would say, was that of perfection. He was interested in creating a product and having that product be the best product that it could be.
My next question is for Elle. But as a stylist, Elle, seeing Jay's portfolio earlier this year, tell me about your thoughts just seeing it, his designs, his drawings. What was going through your mind?
Right. Well, first, I would like to say that I'm honored to be here on behalf of Jay Jaxon. Thank you, Rachel. But when I first saw his portfolio at the top of the year, it was actually my first time even knowing about Jay Jaxon. I felt as though it was like discovering gold or something like that. It was like the final piece to a certain puzzle, because to me that represented true representation. And beforehand, I really hadn't seen myself reflected in the industry that way. And to see that a Black man was able to travel in a transcontinental way to go and learn in Paris and get that refinement and design at a couture level house and come back to America and be able to have his own business, that was very aspirational or inspirational to me. So it was a very visceral feeling of appreciation, and I felt honored to be able to touch it and to go throughout his portfolio and to even see letters that Givenchy himself wrote to Jay Jaxon was mind-blowing, and I've never seen anything like it.
Now, you wrote an amazing article, actually, on really the impact of Black people in fashion, right? As well as the challenges that they face, which really goes in line with Rachel's presentation. It was called, you titled it, I don't know if it was you specifically, Crabs in a Seventh Ave Barrel, Black Professional Exclusion in the Fashion Industry. And then I think what most importantly about your article was that not only did you talk about the challenges, but then you actually presented three proposals to actually address the shortcomings of Blacks in fashion. Could you tell us a little bit about your process getting there, like how did your thinking evolve, and how did you come up with those three-step solutions?
Right. Well, that article came out of frustration of working in an industry that was marginalizing people of color, Black professionals. It just seems as though there's a glass ceiling that we weren't able to break through, especially seeing all of the things that were happening in the media last year with Gucci and Prada and Burberry, the list goes on. And I felt myself working for brands necessarily didn't value my mind, but more so valued my aesthetic. Or my they didn't value my personhood as a Black person. So constructing that, I surveyed the industry and I asked professionals and I interviewed people to actually come up with some type of information so that I could put into this. So the three-pronged plan was we need to have reformation of the entire fashion industry. And I suggested that we use the NAACP to work alongside the fashion industry to make sure that we can kind of survey the industry and have diversity reporting, as some of us were saying that we need to know the statistics and the numbers inside of these companies. Secondly, was that we need ownership. We need vertically integrated businesses. We need Black people who are stakeholders in their companies, as well as trickling down to the managers and the supervisors, and majority being ran by Black people. And so I see it's comparable to LVMH or a Kering Group. You know, these are holding companies that kind of develop and make sure that their creators can be creative while they take care of the business. So I feel as though Black brands, we need that type of overarching system. The last was, we need an incubator system to basically pour funding into emerging talent, as well as developing them, giving them skills and the allocated spaces to be able to create, as well as some type of mentorship that these young designers would need to come into the industry.
Thank you for that.
Who
focusing on fashion and Jay's role in that, Renee, you told Rachel an intriguing story about a dress that he made for you. Could you tell us that story here? And Rachel, as a follow-up to that, yeah, you thought I was gonna, that I forgot about you there. Could you tell us how that story aligned with what you have come to know about Jay?
So I think it was his senior project, and it was a dress. And also, at the time, there was a really big fashion party. It's now called, it's something at the museum, but it was called the Couturiers. And in those days, back in the dark ages, they would give students at FIT tickets to go. So Jay designed this incredibly beautiful dress to me. It was very simple. It was a round neck. It had 100 buttons down the front that had to be buttoned and looped, all handmade. It was long sleeve, it was 16-ply crepe cut on the bias. My hair was pulled back, I wore a Chanel black bow with Camilla in it. And we went to the ball, and it was truly a movie. In those days, there was still a pool on the main floor of the Metropolitan Museum. It was very glamorous. It was still all the waiters in the white jackets with the champagne glasses walking by. And I walked in and I thought, whoa, this is a movie. I have seen this movie. It was glorious. And I said, I like it here. And Ray and I had the best time. I mean, we just had a really fun time. And so these guys came over to me and said, what agency are you with? And I'm like, I'm not in an agency. And they said, well, two men came to me and said, come see me tomorrow. They were both in 550. One was Donald Brooks, that Jay eventually worked for. One was a Jacques Tufaud. So I cut my class the next day, and I went to 550, and I went to Donald Brooks, who I found out never came in before 1 o'clock or after lunch. And so I went to stop down at Jacques Tufaud, who hired me. Okay. So that creative process was very incredible working with him because he dresses made for me, on me. And I don't think I kept it though. I think he had to turn it in for a class project. So that's how I got started in modeling. I mean, that was my kind. And it was just very simple for me at the time. It was different, you know, for women at the time. There weren't that many women of color on 7th Avenue, but there were a few. I was not the first by any means, but I was maybe fourth, fifth, but they had been models along 7th Avenue. So that was fun, and that's how I started in the business. And I worked for Jacques as what they called a house model, which means that they fit the collection on you, and then you do things like sharpen the pencils. In those days, buy it. Boat orders and pencils. So you sharpen the pencil, you make sure that, you know, carbon papers were in. And then eventually other designers called me and I went to work with them and I just started to freelance. And I did that for, I guess, 7 years, something like that. Because at that point in time, you get 1 year older and the new models are 5 years younger. And I don't care what you lift and tuck and nip, 16 is 16. And you can't compete. I didn't want to compete. That's not my game. I don't compete like that. So that working with Jay in that way, I know we were still hanging out and having a great time, but he talked about concept. Jay had a concept that he once explained to me, and he called it hoax. H-O-A-X. And he maintained that most women fall into one of those letters, their shape. We all know who the X is, right? That's kind of like the hourglass figure. That's the X. The A is the one who is narrow of shoulders and wider hips, also called an apple. The H was kind of like I was, which means you're kind of a straight up and down person, no particular, not a great waist. And the O was the round person. And I don't know if he ever really, I think that's how he conceived a lot of his clothing, because he was very clear about that. And I said, okay, sounds like a good idea to me. But that's kind of one of the process that we discussed about how he got to where he was going. question. Did I answer the question?
Oh, you did. Okay. Rachel, you want to follow up with that?
So I will follow up in regards to the dress. So when I first met Ms. Renee Hunter and she gave me her tie with her, I thought that the dress was super interesting in terms of all the details, the fabric details, that it was on a bias cut. Also, I think it also shows to Jay Jaxon's brilliance. I too am also a fashion designer, so to create garments on a bias cut is extremely difficult. And the fact that they had 100 buttons that the center front, and that it was also a floor-length gown, I was super impressed by the story. And so I thought, okay, if we're going to do an exhibition or we're going to talk, I knew for sure that Ms. Renee Hunter, that your story would be something that the crowd would want to hear or also want to know about Jay.
Between fashion in the 70s, 80s to now, and I really think that Elle can speak on that. But my last question for the panelists is this. How important is Jay really to the fashion narrative, to French history, to American history, to where we are now in terms of fashion? And I'm gonna actually begin with Elle.
I think he is important in all of those categories and all of those narratives. I feel as though he has something to offer each specific one. For an American standpoint, I feel as though we don't really know sometimes in American history who started things or who were the first. And so I think today we actually get to experience this exhibit to see how he was the first in fashion and how much of a pioneer he was. When it comes to all of the other narratives as well, I feel as though it's just important that we have representation and that we have something to look forward to. Because as we all know, representation kind of, you know, creates our reality for us. And so when we see someone like Jay Jaxon, we see ourselves in the world and that we can, you know, aspire to be just as great.
Jay is probably one of the most important designers that there've been in the 20th, not, and maybe in the 21st century. Jay went unrecognized except for those of us who were very close to him and certain people that he worked for. His concepts were exceptional. You could put on a Jay Jaxon suit today and be as fashionable as you were 40 years ago. His clothes were timeless, and as it was mentioned, he loved the concept of the bias. He was always talking about the bias and how he was designing various outfits that were based on the bias, and he looked for fabrics that would fall into this category. Not only did he look for fabrics, he created fabrics and designed fabrics. It is really unfortunate that a number of young people and even older people have no idea who Jay Jaxon is, because he is one of the people that should be recognized in all narratives.
Well, things being the way they are in this country and around the world, some things are gonna get better, others all the way. Jay is like finding new pan gold. And they haven't hit the vein yet where the miners are gonna walk away rich from his talent. And with social media in place now, I think it's gonna be a plus that Jay can be around the world for everyone to see and to know and to fit into their life as they wear his designs, and as part of history.
Well, we all know what history is. History is written by the winner. Is write our own history. They're gonna keep us buried. Thank God for Rachel, who dug up our wonderful friend Jay Jaxon, because that's what we need. We need to get on it and to bring it forward. We cannot rely on other people to do our work. It's not their job. It is our job. It's our job to say, here, look at this man, and to keep saying it until they look, because it's not going to happen otherwise. It's our job to bring all of these young people, especially people like Jay back in the day, but from him as well, Smith, there was Stephen Burroughs, I mean, he's just got Barry. They all came after him. But, and they're going to be lost, too. They're almost lost as we speak. So it's our job. And I thank Rachel for doing this. It's our job to write our history, because somebody else will write it, and it won't be the truth. Everybody writes their own truth. We need to get on this, and we need to stay on it. And like I say, just keep saying, here he is, here he is, this is what he did. And I think that could possibly help, and I think that Jay is a perfect person to start our project.
So to finalize and answer your question, you know, when I first started this project on Jay Jaxon, I did receive a little pushback in terms of, well, why do you want to write about him? He's one of many designers who has been lost in the historical narrative. And I was like, well, first, none of them grew up in the Jim Crow era, and none of them were producing fashion, or also none of them were the first to take over an haute couture house. So I'm going to write this project, and it's going to happen. It doesn't matter. I know that you may not understand, but I understand the importance. And so I decided, okay, if I'm going to start this project, and I'm going to talk about historical issues, social barriers, you know, of course, I need to meet his friends and his family, also speak with them. And then there was an interesting story when I met with a friend of Jay Jaxon's in Paris. And he told me, you know, that Jay Jaxon is just as huge as Yves Saint Laurent and all of these other designers. And, you know, he said, you know what, he should have been even bigger, but it was just the time period. And it was just the experience that he was going through in Paris. And I said, you know, well, why did he leave Paris? And he said, you know, Rachel, he left Paris because of the racism he experienced in the couture houses. And so I said, okay, from there, I wanted to know more. And I was, okay, well, what happened when he came back to New York? Again, it was another narrative that came up. It was racism that he experienced in the fashion houses in New York City. And then also when he went to California, there was a 10-year gap in his career in which he stopped designing for fashion houses. But what he did during that time period was actually go back to school. He went to USC and got a degree or a business certificate so that he can start another fashion company creating plus-size garments. So he was always, you know, consistently an entrepreneur, always someone who loved fashion. He returned to the industry and started working with TV and film. And, you know, this is another narrative that came up again. And one day, I was speaking with Lloyd Hardy, which is Jay Jaxon's partner. And he said, you know, Rachel, Jay said to me, you know, wow, the fashion industry isn't racist anymore. And this, he was speaking to his experience in California. So what I took from that is, you know, I think, did he experience a moment of, you know, I don't want to have to deal with this type of issues or problems, and also that I'm a certified designer, I create, I do well, I've succeeded at the highest level of what is considered to be high-level fashion. I should be able to work in all of these instances, and I shouldn't have barriers to entry, yes. And perhaps maybe that's part of the reason why he wanted to take a break. But at the same time, he was consistent and persevered. And I think that that's something that anyone who's coming up in this industry should be able to look towards. You know, I went to Parsons in New York. I studied fashion design. I never heard of Jay Jaxon. Then I went to Parsons in Paris. I was studying fashion theory, fashion studies, fashion history. Never heard of Jay Jaxon. So I said, okay, I'm going to make sure that we know about his story. And I think it's super important. Like Jay, I'm also from Queens, New York, so it was super important to me. I used to go to this library. My mom would take me here. I lived a few blocks away from Jay, where Jay lived in St. Albans, Queens. We went to the same church and things of that sort. So I thought, wow, this person who took the same bus as me, went to the same schools as me, I can do it too. And so I wanted to make sure that Jay Jaxon's story, which was so influential to me, would be influential to her.
And definitely thank the panelists, let's give them a round of applause for participating in our panel discussion about Jay Jaxon. You know, if it's one thing that everyone should know is that history is vibrant, right? It's relevant. It's relevant to now. But in order for us to understand where we are going, we have to know where we've been. And that requires anytime somebody who has been as monumental as Jay, anytime they have been written out of history, it's our job to make sure that we reinstate them where they rightfully belong. So I want to thank Rachel for her thesis, the panelists again, for just giving us a little insight, both in their personal dealings with Jay, as well as discussing the relevancy of fashion today. All right, so that will conclude our program here. I just want to remind everyone there will be a live band and refreshments after this program. Feel free to go up to the panelists. Yes, I'm going to send everyone to you. Ask them questions. Discuss what their thoughts are, both about fashion as well as the icon that really is Jay Jaxon. Thank you. Mm-hmm.